Whilst all of this rubbish was going on back on the Dark Railway, Character Smash was very much enjoying his time out on the mainline, hauling charter trains and seeing how much the world had changed since the last time he had been on the national network. Being based in a big steam centre, Caracas got to meet lots of different engines, from small tank engines permanently based on the site, to fellow mainline charter engines popping in for routine checkup between taking trains. Unfortunately, a constant thorn in his side was Barry, who had followed him up to the depot and would not leave him alone, often embarrassing him in front of the other engines. This was the cause of some friction between the two of them one day, when an open event was being hosted at the depot. Caracas had been positioned next to some other mainline performers, and was awestruck to be held in the same high regard as them. One of them spoke up, and visitors milled around.
So, Caracticus, is it?
Caracas. Caracas Smash.
Well, Mr. Smash, welcome back to the front line. Very impressed we are, aren't we? Yes.
Oh, absolutely. You look like you've had an excellent job done on your restoration.
Well, my owner worked on me for a long time. I'm named after him, actually.
Huh. What was your name before?
I didn't have one.
Well, regardless, now you have nameplates and expertly applied livery there, Caracas. You should be proud.
Yes, indeed. I mean, look at me in my shiny paintwork and my shiny nameplates. I'm such a splendid engine.
We are all splendid engines, Guardsmen, and therefore must be treated with the utmost respect. Yourself included, Caracas, of course.
Caracas gloried in these comments. In years past, he had never really been shown much respect from other engines due to his lack of a name. But now, he was being treated with what felt like actual respect and admiration.
Just look at all those people looking at us. They know we're incredibly special engines.
And they're all incredibly impressed with us, aren't they?
Oh yes, indeed they are. Now then, Caracas, I would like to ask you something.
Okay.
Myself, Mayflower, and Guardsman here are part of a lucrative and exclusive group of fine express passenger engines who operate all over the country. Now, my question to you is this. Would you like to become part of our exclusive little club here?
Hey up, Carrot Smosh. Oh, what's this? You've made some friends.
Ew, gross.
Get it away from me! All that grime and soot is going to ruin my splendid paintwork.
Do you know this engine, Caracas?
Caracas blushed. We're colleagues. My owner, Mr. Smash, also owns him. He followed me here, actually, without permission, Barry.
I think you'll find that Barry doesn't need permission to do anything. Barry does what Barry wants, and that's just the meaning of life.
I see. Well, if you are indeed friendly with this grimy, uncouth locomotive.
I'm not! I don't even like him! He's like a bad cough that just won't go away!
Hey now, Barry followed you to protect you from the evils and nasties and governments in the world. Like this lot of pompous stuck-up bellend right here.
Oh, I think I might faint!
The language on this engine is absolutely atrocious.
How rude. Well, if he is not your friend, Caracas, then you'd better get him to leave us in peace. Otherwise, I may have to take back my offer. I can't support your membership if I know that you hang around with riffraff such as this.
Caracas looked rather shocked. He had just been about to be made a member of what sounded like a proper organisation of highly respected mainline-ready engines. And here was Barry, embarrassing him as usual, ruining his chance of becoming part of something new. He had to do something. Would you excuse me for a moment? Barry, come over here! The two engines steamed away to another part of the yard, away from everybody else. As soon as they were out of earshot, he rounded on Barry quite aggressively. Right, you! Ever since I first had the displeasure of meeting you, all you've done is wind me up, annoy me, embarrass me, and ruin any opportunities that have come my way. I was happy to go to the Dark Railway and get away from you, but no, you had to come and live there too. Then Mr. Smash gives me this fine opportunity to prove myself as a real mainline machine, and you come and follow me here too. And now, I'm about to be invited to join a clan of respected, magnificent mainline engines, and yet again you're there, in my shadow, trying to actively ruin my life? What is the deal? Do you not want me to be happy or something? Are you so dissatisfied with your own life that you feel that you need to destroy mine well? Well? Barry looked genuinely puzzled for a moment before he replied.
But I don't understand. I come with you to keep you company and to protect you. Because we're friends, aren't we?
No, Barry. We are most certainly not friends. Haven't you listened to a single word I just said? I can't fucking stand you and your stupid childish insanity! I can't take it anymore!
What can I do to sort out this rancid mess then, Car Keys?
My name is Caracus! Caracus Smash! Just like our owner! I'm sick of this shit! You wanna sort this out, Barry? Go away! Go home and leave me alone!
But...
Fuck off, Barry!
Oh, that hurts, you know.
There's more coming if you don't leave me alone. Go away. Go away. Barry took one look at the seriousness on Caracus' smoke box. Without saying another word, Barry rolled away to the other side of the depot, whilst Caracus slunk back up to the main sheds to see if he could salvage his invitation. Back in the south of England, Ed and Sid had been sent to a start-up preserved railway in Hampshire, based in Ringwood. The two engines were familiar with the place, having occasionally worked trains down here from their home on the nearby Somerset and Dorset line. However, they noticed that the station was a shell of its former self, having clearly been abandoned for some time. Thankfully, the volunteers restoring the line and station were very enthusiastic, and soon, they had repaired enough of the line to allow heritage train services to begin. Ed and Sid were rather happy about this. Well, it might not be our good old S&D, but it's somewhere familiar at the very least. I still hate seeing the station the way it is. Overgrown. Damaged. Yes, but these guys are clearly passionate about repairing it. And if they say it's good enough to run some trains, then that's a good thing, right? I guess so. I'm just a bit fed up of sitting here, that's all. Who are you and what have you done with my Sid? The Sid I know would never want to actively go out and work. Oh, I don't know. It's just that we've been sat around for such a long time that I'm actually keen to work. Do you know what? You're right, Sid. We were asked to come here and help, and I think we definitely should do just that. Agreed. They didn't have to wait long. For a few days later, the volunteers came to the two engines and began preparing them for work. Does that mean the line's ready to open?
As ready as we can afford to make it.
We've tried our hardest to repair the track as much as possible. This is where you two come in.
We would like to ask you both to double-head our celebratory reopening train for our supporters and volunteers. However, we would like to set you both an additional task.
An additional task? Is it something difficult? I don't do well with difficult scenarios.
Oh, nothing too stressful. We would just like you to give us some feedback on our repair work to the line.
For example, if you notice any bumpy sections of track, can you please let us know?
Oh, that's fine. We can do that, can't we, Sid? Of course!
Thank you, both of you.
I don't know what we would have done without your owner's help. We have a nice collection of rolling stock, but no operational engines.
It's been very difficult trying to source operational locomotives recently, as most other preservation societies either cannot spare any or don't take our efforts seriously.
Which is a shame, because we have worked incredibly hard to repair what we have here.
We really are very grateful for you and your owner's help, though.
It's not a problem. We're glad to do it. Besides, we've worked on this railway line before.
Really?
Oh yes. Back in the 1950s, we would sometimes run trains along here, when diversions were in place. We've discussed this previously. We want to see you guys succeed. and you all seem very genuine and enthusiastic about saving this railway line.
That we are.
Well, what are we waiting for then? Why don't me and Sid go out with those wagons over there today and help check the line for you now? That way we can see if there's any problems to resolve before the line officially reopens.
That's actually not a bad idea.
If you guys ride in the brake vans, you can feel for yourselves as well if there's anywhere that needs attention. The volunteers agreed to this plan, and shortly, the two engines were coupled up at either end of the train of wagons before moving off down the line. Ed and Sid were incredibly impressed with the railway line. They felt the rails as aft, feeding back to the volunteers as they rolled along the line, over bridges and up embankments, before ascending down to a passing loop. Here, the volunteers checked that the engines and the wagons were okay, before proceeding to short distance through a cutting towards the other station at a place called Holmesley. The men awaited their feedback nervously.
So, what did you think? Is the track work alright so far?
Apart from a couple of bumpy bits on that downhill section near the passing loop, yeah, it feels alright to me. How about you, Sid? I felt a bit of a jolt at that last bridge, and a bit near that loop, but otherwise, you guys have done a good job. Considering that you're trying to recondition old track too, it all seems satisfactory. The men breathed a sigh of relief, and the train headed back in the other direction back to Ringwood. Once there, the two engines discussed more observations on their return journey before retiring to the sheds for the day. Both of them were seriously impressed. Do you know what, Sid? What, Ed? I think we're going to enjoy our time here, don't you? Yeah, they're genuinely pleased with their hard work, and so am I. Let's hope that their reopening is successful. Best behaviour from both of us, I think. We'll do our best. And they did. Once they had run the Society's special opening day train, the two engines settled down into regular operation on the Castleman's Railway, becoming the line's main motive power for the time being. Though Ed and Sid occasionally missed their home on the Dark Railway, they were secretly quite satisfied with their current living arrangements, and continued to put in a good performance for the benefit of the young men restoring this quaint little railway. Meanwhile, heading back north, Lino had also settled into life on the railway that he had been sent to. This railway line was a lot more developed than the one that Ed and Sid were visiting, and had the benefit of having several operational locomotives to run trains. At first, Lino questioned why he had been specifically asked to operate here, and he soon found out why. As the other operational engines were much younger than him, Lino was the perfect candidate to operate the railway's vintage train of older carriages, which certainly helped to draw in the crowds. The other engines present were also intrigued by Lino's strong performances on the line's stiff gradients.
I just don't know how you manage it. Those old coaches aren't exactly light.
Even I, a strong freight engine, find this line a bit tricky to operate.
Right there, mate, just how do you do that then?
I suppose it's because I'm used to inclines. Back home, we have very steep inclines, and one of my main tasks used to be to run the branch trains up to a quarry town. I think the gradient's about 1 in 50 most of the way.
No wonder you're good at hill climbing, look at you. You beautiful bastard.
I'm surprised you can even climb hills, though with such large driving wheels.
Something I think our friend here has more than the rest of us though is experience. If you climb hills long enough, you become something of an expert on it, I feel.
Oh, don't get me wrong. I wasn't questioning his, not anybody else's abilities.
I know, don't worry. I'm just saying, it's all down to experience.
Lino settled back to listen to the meandering conversation, slowly losing track of the topic and drifting off to sleep. One dreary day, Lino arrived at the bottom station on the line, where there was a connection to the main line that ran past. In order to run round his train, Lino rolled underneath the big footbridge and onward to a crossover. Whilst he was stopped, he suddenly heard a whistle from the main line. That must be a steam special coming through. The passengers seem to be milling over to watch it, though. I'll just wait here and have a look for myself. Who knows? Could be someone familiar. But Lino had no idea how familiar this encounter would be. As the engine whistled again, he saw it run through the station, almost a scarlet blur. What struck him was that he suddenly felt a wave of nausea as he spotted the number and nameplate. Shaking slightly, he quickly reversed back through the platforms and the steam special disappeared. His driver was concerned.
What's wrong with you, Lino? You're shaking?
I'm okay. The driver chuckled.
You sound like you've just seen a ghost.
Lino felt a drop in his boiler as he heard those words. I think I have. Wait a moment. Lino began thinking hard as he coupled up to his coaches. No, she couldn't have. Could she? No, surely not. That's ridiculous. But what if she... and Mr. Smash? And the fire? Oh, that silly girl! What does she think she's doing? Further north, the situation between Barry and Caracas had not improved. Despite Barry's best and most annoying efforts, Caracas still wouldn't talk to him, and tried to avoid him as much as he could. On the same rainy day as Lino's fright, Caracas had left the depot early to haul an excursion train. Barry, who had yet again tried to speak to him to wish him luck on his excursion, was completely ignored as Caracas left the yard. Feeling dejected, Barry lurked off to the back of the sheds, on his own, contemplating going home after all. Late in the afternoon, as the rain outside got heavier and the skies darkened, the depot supervisor came to the sheds, walking up to the three big engines. Barry, hiding in the shadows at the back of the sheds, listened intently.
A problem's arisen on the main line, and I need your assistance, please. Number 7447 has suffered a failure and is stranded just down the line from here. Can one of you please volunteer to rescue him in his train?
The three engines looked at each other.
Well, I would, but it's raining cats and dogs out there. What if it turns into hailstones and damages my lovely paintwork? How dare you suggest to me that I risk my splendidness just to rescue that other engine? Whatever his name was.
I suppose that would mean one of us having to complete his journey too? Sorry, sir, but I'm just too important to do it. Especially if there's no reward for myself in the deal.
And I've just been cleaned, so there's no way I'm going out there. If he is broken down, then that is his problem, not mine. Association with that other grubby engine, of course, means that he's not worthy of our time, even there for all we care.
At this point, Barry couldn't stand by any longer. He rolled forwards furiously.
And you lot call yourselves his friend, yet won't go out and help him in his time of need? I know I'm not the sharpest tool in the shed here, but let me tell you, Barry has principles, and Barry knows a bad egg when he sees one. And you lot smell particularly rotten.
Excuse me, I don't smell.
Oh, but you do, Sonny Jim. You smell horrid. Your attitude stinks worse than a portable loo after curry night. You're so caught up in how you look and how... splendid you all are. But let me tell you, you're nothing but a bunch of nasty, selfish, trumped up little puffs. Now then, if you'll excuse me, I'm going to rescue my friend.
He's already told you that he's not even your friend. Why would you risk going out in that weather to rescue someone who hates you?
Because Barry is love, and Barry has a conscience. He's my shedmate, and my colleague. And despite everything, I'm not just going to stand by knowing he's out there, all alone and suffering. As for the weather... you lot are just a bunch of pansies, aren't you? A little rain never hurt Barry, so off Barry goes. And mark my words, you'll be hearing from my bricklayers.
And with that, Barry stormed out of the sheds, whilst the supervisor shouted his instructions on how to rescue Caracas. Barry ventured quickly out onto the main line, being slotted in between service trains so that he could travel down to Caracas's location. But to his great surprise, when he arrived, he found not only Caracas, but another steam engine as well. The same one that Lena had seen earlier that day.
Hello, Barry. It's been a long time since I last saw you at Mr. Smash's works.
Barry seemed very confused.
Hey, oh. Repulse?
Yes. Yes, it's me.
What are you doing here? And what's with the Black Railway Killer Corpse dress-up?
Well, it's a long story, but it's not important right now. I was diverted here to bring Caracas back to the depot. Aren't you going to say anything, Caracas?
Caracas grumbled under his breath.
Oh, come on! I know that you said Barry drives you mad, and that you're not talking to him anymore, but he'd come all the way out here in this weather to rescue you. Doesn't that say something about him?
He was probably sent out here by the Yard. Doesn't mean anything. I'm sure one of the others would have come, but no. Barry wants all the glory, and it's a great excuse to try and put Barry cut him off.
I came out here by choice. Those other engines were talking smack about you. Couldn't be bothered to come out in the rain to rescue their so-called friend. But Barry told them so. I wanted to come out and rescue you and get you out of harm's way. Because, despite everything, I do still give two tosses about you, Caracas.
Caracas was surprised by this. He couldn't even remember Barry calling him by his proper name before. This convinced him that Barry was, for the first time, being sincere. They didn't want to help?
No. They were too concerned about ruining their paintwork, and knew they wouldn't get any glory from rescuing a stranded engine or train. Barry doesn't go hunting for glory. Barry goes hunting for his friends.
Are you talking about the likes of that Green Arrow and Scots Guardsman?
And that puffed up Mayflower, yes.
I know of them. They think they're so big and clever, but they're full of themselves and care for nobody but themselves. You're definitely wise to steer clear of them. You don't want to become like them, Caracas, alone and friendless such as they are.
Caracas thought for a moment. You're right. I don't want to become like that. Barry.
Hey, up.
I'm sorry for how I've been treating you recently. I know I can't take back what I've said, but...
Aw, shucks. That's alright. No need to worry. I understand your frustration, you know. I'm not the easiest of engines to get on with. I realise that.
Well, I shouldn't have had a go at you for being yourself.
And I shouldn't have been so pestering and irritating.
Now that you boys have kissed and make up, shall we go back to the depot and get out of this bloody rain?
The two engines agreed. Repulse and Barry coupled up in front of Caracas, and the two engines snorted into life, dragging the damaged Britannia and his train back towards the yard. When they arrived, Repulse uncoupled and hesitated for a moment.
What's wrong? I don't want to see that lot. They ask me too many questions. They know of Leander's reputation, you see. But I still don't understand why. It isn't important. Look, Barry can take you back to the sheds, and I can take the train onwards for you both, okay? Just don't mention me to them. And please, when you go back to the Dark Railway, please don't say anything about me. I'd rather they didn't know.
Both engines promised that they wouldn't, and after a few moves, Repulse was coupled to the train and hurried away. Barry brought Caracas up through the yard and into the main sheds, where the three mainliners began to chuckle.
How's the rain? Got some more limescale to add to the collection?
Congratulations, you rescued him. Now you can leave us in peace so we can find out the juicy gossip. Yes.
Only clean, name-plated engines are allowed in here now. We have made our final decision.
Barry looked very depressed as he went to leave, but Caracas stopped him. Do you know what? Barry rescued me today. whilst you lot stayed here making snide remarks and worrying about your precious paintwork. I think that you should all give him some sort of apology for the way you've been behaving too. I've never met such a bunch of stuck-up, pompous, self-serving engines in my entire life. As for your little club, forget it. Barry has proven to me what real friendship is all about. He's 20 times the engine that you lot will ever be. Famous, popular, named, clean, whatever it is. Now, if you'll excuse us, we're going to go and make our own little club. But for proper engines, not trumped-up museum pieces like you lot. Come on, Barry. There's a nice little carriage shed at the other end of the depot. Barry obliged, shunting Caracas slowly out of the sheds, whilst the other engines just stared, with shocked expressions on their smoke boxes. Over at the carriage shed, the two engines got chatting.
Thanks for standing up for me back there.
That's okay, Barry. I know that I've got to be more tolerable of your quirkiness.
And I promise to try and stop being such an irritant.
Don't worry about that too much, mate. But I'll tell you one thing. You've rescued me from more than one thing today.
Hey, oh, have I?
Yes. I dread to think the engine I would have become if I had remained in their company much longer. I come from a much more humble background, as you know. I know how it feels to be underappreciated, ignored, thought less of by other engines, and I should have remembered that a lot earlier. So for that, I thank you, Barry, for stopping me becoming something I'm not.
Well, what are friends for, eh?
Yeah, what are friends for?
Speaking of friends, though, what's going on with little Miss Repulsive? Why is she dressed up like that other one?
I don't really know. I don't know why she'll want to be decorated with that other engine's name and number, considering everything that she was responsible for.
Well, I don't think we really need to know. Want to know what I do think?
Go on.
I think we should ditch this joint and go home.
Barry, that's the best idea you've had all week.
Shall we?
Yes, let's do it.
I'm afraid that you two can't go home. Or at least not yet anywhere.
The two engines looked down to see the supervisor of the depot looking up at them.
Listen, you. If Barry and his bezzy mate, Carrot Cake... Caracas... want to go home, then we bloody well will, and there's nothing you can do to stop us.
I'm afraid it's not as simple as that.
Why not?
Because your home railway has been disconnected from the national network. British Rail decided to close a branch line connecting it last week, and I couldn't help overhearing your conversation. So I just want to make you both aware of the situation before you two try galvanizing up into the sun together.
Barry and Caracas looked perplexed.
Besides, Your Honour called me earlier this evening to request that you two stay out on the main line until a solution's found. Sorry, but for now you're stuck out here.
The supervisor walked away, leaving Caracas and Barry both looking rather concerned.
It creates the new ways of
oh.